So, you should have already downloaded Docker. So it can be, I don't know why this uses Yahoo as the default. It takes like 100 clicks to get to the place where you can download Docker. You can get Docker CE Community Edition. So Docker, for those that don't know, so Docker is a really cool kind of virtualization platform. So if you want to virtualize something, you essentially can either run it in a VM where you have a completely emulated and virtualized piece of hardware, or you can, like what I do for your homework assignments, when I'm running and testing your homework assignments, I'm running each of them in a chroot jail, right, which runs as a process on the system, but each of them sees as the root directory whatever directory I can find them to. So Docker is built on Linux containers, so the idea is you can, I think it's called LXC is the extension there. Basically, you can assign different containers to different different processes to run in different containers, and then Docker uses different file systems, so each instance that you run basically gets access to this different file system. It's a really cool technology. I suggest you look into it more. If you don't install it, that'll be great. If you're on Linux, you'll need to run sudo, as somebody pointed out, on the mailing list. The cool thing about Docker, so it's, like I said, it's for Linux, essentially, but they have distributions for Mac and Windows, where essentially they're running a VirtualBox system with an emulated, a virtual Linux system that Docker is then talking to when you run everything there. Let's see, the other really cool things about Docker are, just like Git, so every kind of commit or change to your repo is specified. What is that? Am I hitting buttons? I don't know what that is.
It's gone now.
All right, cool. So one of the things that Docker solves, which is really awesome, is that when anybody do like dev work in a professional company, yeah, how many people also had to deal with deploying and running that same software? Right? And a lot of companies are separate, right? So you have the developers who develop software and the ops people who actually run things, right? And so you can get into problems where one of the classic bug things is works on my machine, right? So like a lot of developers are like, I don't see what the problem is. It works on my machine. It must be an ops problem. And part of that comes in because the configuration that you're using to run the software and develop the software is different from where it's actually deployed. So Docker is really nice because you can specify, and they have a repository like GitHub where people can push repositories and changes. And so when you say, like here, Docker pulled this image, I know that everyone's getting the exact same file system, the exact same everything. So that's why people use this in production. So that you can have a Docker image that is your dev image will be exactly the same as what's deployed in production. That's another nice thing. Okay, so if you pull this means now it's gonna pull down all the changes of the latest version of Wacko Pico to your system. If you haven't run this yet, you should install Docker, then run this command so it pulls down everything because it's kind of large. And then now the question is, how do we run it? And I actually can't remember. So let's ask Docker for help. No mix. Whoa, Docker. Alright. So we can run. So we're going to run a new container. I just flushed. I completely reinstalled my OS, so I don't know how my old commands are running these. Anybody know how I run it?
Docker run dash D.
Dash D for Damon.
Yeah, and then dash P.
Lowercase?
Lowercase, yeah. And then like 80 semicolon, 80 semicolon. Or colon.
Which way? Yeah,
just 80 colon 80 semicolon.
I don't think that'll
work for me. I don't know.
Probably running it as root.
Yeah.
basically has scripts in it to run the application. The dash D command tells Docker to run this in the background, so your first time to make sure that it actually works. I'm going to get rid of that. The dash P is a port mapping. So when the container runs, it's running a web server on port 80 that's going to be listening for all your incoming connections, right? But that's only inside Docker, so that port is only exposed inside that Docker container. The other 80, and actually you probably need to look up which one's which. The other 80 says externally map this on the current machine I am on port 80 to that, which may not work if you already have something running on port 80. So let's say, I think we do Docker run test H. So should we run everything? I just did defp 80:80. So this maps port 80 on my local machine to port 80 inside the Docker container. And then I can control C to kill it. Host port, container port, there we go. Okay, so to run this on something that is not port 80, because if maybe you can't do that, maybe you have something already running there. So when you put the 8080 first, that's your host port. The second one is the Docker port. So I believe if you run this, then you gotta maybe wait a little while it boots up, and then it's doing things, and then what it's saying is it spawned MySQL D, so it's running MySQL, it's running Apache. Now if I go to localhost, colon 8080, it will activate this stuff. So you should be able to see something like this. Alright, so everyone get there. Docker, it's great because I know you'll all have the same thing. You'll all have a copy on your local host that should be running. If you're there, hack it. I mean, it's web stuff.
Just do it.
You don't have to wait for me.
Start hacking.
Yeah. We can set a burp in a second, but at least you can start playing with it. The first thing you should do is start playing with it, right? Start seeing what it does.
Hmm?
problem, raise your hand. No shame.
Computers don't work. Are you having problems? Yeah.
or that Burke's default port is 8080. So you can just change your Docker image to something else. It's not a big issue, but. So you use Docker space PS, just like PS on a, just like this, so it'll show you all the containers that are running. If you do Docker kill, if you want to kill this, you just use this container ID, and it will kill that container ID. So now if I refresh this, I should get nothing. I go to 9999. All right, let's set up Merck. Okay, so we want to create a temporary project because we can't save a project because we don't pay for it yet. Use the default start Burp. So the idea of Burp is a proxy fundamentally, so we have to set our browser to use Burp as for all of our outgoing traffic. So Burp is not the greatest user interface, and you can tell it was coded in Java by the amazing user interface here. But it is still, despite the ugly appearances, it is still a really good tool. But like most tools that look really ugly but are very good, it means you have to learn how to use them, right? It's not necessarily on the intuitive side. So what we care about is in the proxy, because we want to mess with the proxy. We can go to the options here, and so we can see that the proxy is running based on the settings on 127.0.0.1.8080. What does the 127.0.0.1 in front of me? Yeah, so, but what does that fundamentally mean?
Subnet.
Yeah, it means that only this applications that are running on this machine can connect to this. Right? This means that I can't connect to your proxy running by trying to connect to port 88. So this means only IP addresses that come from localhost.
Right.
So how do I get this to work? To be honest, the best way to do this is to use Firefox. Firefox has the easiest proxy switching options. There's even extensions that make it even easier. To be completely honest, I don't know how to do it in Chrome because I used to use Chrome as my default browser, and so I didn't want to be doing my hacking stuff in my default browser. So oftentimes, whenever I use Burp, I always just use Firefox, but the steps are basically the same. So we want to change the preferences in Firefox. We want the advanced tab because we're doing crazy advanced voodoo. We want the network because we're changing the network. We're going to change how Firefox connects. And we have this awesome thing to configure how Firefox connects to the network. Manual proxy settings. Burp is an HTTP proxy, so we put localhost. And we do 8080 because that is where Burp is listening. The important thing is, and this is where a lot of people mess up, there's a box here for no proxy for localhost or 127.0.0.1. That's not what we want because we want our traffic for our localhost to go through Burp, so we say no proxy there. And then we click on OK. Now, all the requests that we make, if I refresh this, it should hang. And you can see here that it's hanging, spinning. If we go, wow, this is super annoying, what happened? We can see that the intercept tab of Burp got highlighted. And if we pop over here, we can see that it has intercepted this request from our Firefox browser to localhost 9999. And I can read this, and you can read this, because we spent so much time looking at HTTP requests. So we can see that I'm making a GET request. And so I can click forward, and it will forward it on, and I can keep clicking this. Now, if I keep this on, this intercept on, this means it will wait for me to decide what to do with all of my requests. So I can turn that off, which is cool. What it will do is it will keep track of the history of me browsing this app. So I can click around, click through here, look at that cool flower, I can search. And the cool thing is I can go over here and I can see all of the requests that I made. So I can always see, this is actually one of the key cool things about Burp, is you can see every single request you ever made to this website. Yeah?
Does it store the form content as well? So if I pass user password.
So let's try logging in. Username, password, don't save that Firefox. So if I look here, we can see that it's a post request, and we can see in the post request, just like we know a post request should be, we have username equals username and password equals password in the body of the host request. Yeah.
So I'm trying to like log into the website now. I'm running burp.
Yes.
It like sort of freezes, doesn't run, so go to the website.
Yes, because it's go to the proxy, it's intercepted your request.
All right, so
go to burp.
Yep.
Go to the intercept. So see, it's waiting for you to decide to forward or deny this. So you can unclick that intercept is on left.
Okay.
And now if you go to the proxy, the history, it'll show you all of those requests that it's on. So why is this useful? So this was a correct search. Now, if I change this query to be food tick blah, I don't know, dash dash, I'm just trying to get it to crash. If I click go, it will then show me the response on the right. So I can edit directly in this query parameter in fuzz and just keep sending requests to see what the response is. So we can see here that it gave me the exact same page back. And you can put search terms in here, you can do regular expressions and try to match something. You can look at the headers that get sent, the raw hex, HTML, a rendered version of this page, which I would not recommend. You can see the requests in here. It's got cool things like, let's see, foobar, go. I can right click and I can say, URL code as you type, because I'm editing a parameter here. So now if I do something like this, it will automatically URL encode them. So I can see what I searched for.
Where was that option? The URL.
You right click. It's called URL encode as you type. You can convert a selection. You can right-click and say convert selection. So you actually have here all the different ways to encode it. You have URL encoding, HTML encoding, Base64. This is actually a really powerful way to defend that. So you don't have to, basically the idea is you don't have to keep trying things in your browser, making the request, seeing the response, like doing this over and over, loading all the images and everything. You can just do it right there. See the responses. So based on this, did we think there's a SQL injection vulnerability in this query parameter?
No.
No. Oh, no. Bless you. So find me some vulnerabilities. Yeah.
How do we create users once we're logged in as admin?
I don't know, what does it say?
Warning, require once, create PHP, failed open stream, fail error, require once, failed open stream, create PHP.
I don't know. You tell me, you're the admin.
Did you
good sign, but it means that Burp has intercepted the request. Send to repeater, and then you go to the repeater tab, and so this was the original one I had, and so you can just make requests in here based on that, whatever request you sent to the repeater. That'll be on the left, and then you make changes, hit go, and then it will send that HTTP request, give you that HTTP response on the right-hand side, so you can see how it's changing. intercept. Go to the proxy tab and then intercept. Also, it's probably intercepting all the transmission. If you unclick that intercept, it should just go through, right? Perfect. Now you can see all your requests in the system.
I'll try not to fall on you.
Go to the submission server and tell me what's out of this.
Because I'm not lying around. I'm not sure.
Okay, then send me an email. Because I need to do it. Get it running.
But I'm healthy.
Yeah.
that's the case, and I'll probably just manual interface.
So, yeah, we just need to interface in the video when we call it,
get the output of this SQL injection?
No.
No, it only logs me in, so I can't get the user.
start changing the ID.
Yeah, log in. So, do you create the user? I think I still remember, yeah, the password. So we can look through here, we can see that there's users here. There's Bryce, there's Bob, there's, I don't know, Calvin. I can't remember all these. Sample user, so sample user, if we click through to sample user, we can see something very nice here. User ID equals 1. I change this user ID equals 2, 3, 4, 5. So now let's say I wanted to try to log in as user 2. Right? I can do tick or, what would you guess?
Username.
ID, I already know the IDs. We have to put the space after the dash dash. That's super interesting. I'm not exactly sure why. That's okay, that's one. What else? Yeah.
You can put scripts and CSS and all things in the guest book.
In the guest book, so what is that? What type of vulnerability is that? Cross-site scripting vulnerability. So in the name? In the name? What kind of cross-site scripting is this? Stored cross-site scripting. Awesome. Yes. What is that? Oh, for that. Yeah, that's an exploitation. What are other different types of vulnerabilities?
There's an exception.
You already did one. What else do you want? That.
Go to admin. Yeah, we need to take that last one. Admin, admin.
How did you guess that? Whatever we want there. Yeah. See that with this, so this would be the thing. So we can either do sleep, we can try to do a ping with a certain count, like ping some IP address, anything to get the server to sleep or do some work to delay so we can see that this actually succeeded. This is a bad password. So then we can use this to pretty much do anything, right? We could write out to a file, we could add our, we could curl, try to curl for a file from us, put it into a directory as a .php file, and then execute that directory so we get remote code execution from here. Let's see, oh, we could, let's say this. We could do a backtick ls space dash la, and then output that into, what, foo, and then backtick, actually, like this. So what if we went to foo, is this gonna work? No. So I think the permissions, we have to deal with the permissions here, because our www data user may not be able to write to this folder. So we may be able to do this, though, to the uploads folder, because we know there's an uploads folder that we can upload files to, which is in upload. Yeah, so let's try this. Let's do, it's actually really difficult as a password field. ls-la. Load slash foo. Oh, it's upload. Ah. So there we have the output of LS. So now we can see all, and we can see that this did verify that all of these are owned by root. So it makes sense that the www data user can't access that. So we can do all kinds of cool stuff from here. Yeah, somebody got a vulnerability? Yeah.
If we go to,
I gotta log in. Bryce also has a very bad password. Go to cart?
Yeah. Go to, like, give me.
Well, this is only $1, so yeah. Alright.
Click on delete checkbox.
Delete.
Then continue to confirmation. Okay, so like here it should say like the item is deleted because for confirmation.
But I never click the remove from cart button. Because it's a very poorly designed website. But yeah, that would be interesting. If that did that and it persisted, that would be interesting. What else? Yeah.
The CSS.
Yeah, so that's a good one. So there, none of these forms have CSRF protection. So for instance, writing a comment on a picture, I believe, although there may be posts. So yeah, you could create, you could force people to take actions on this site without them knowing, just by creating an image tag that points to that.
You can upload images for other users as well.
Yeah, so you can get them to upload images for you. What else? Anything else? That's it. Not most of them, but good ones.
You get a coupon from, where is it? Somewhere on the main page.
On the, I believe it's.
You what's going on and hit next day a few times. And then you go back to the purchasing a image, you can enter that in infinitely to reduce it to basically
four. Oh yeah. What kind of vulnerability is this?
A logical.
Yeah, so this is a logic flaw, right? So the code is still working correctly, but if I go to confirm, I get reduced. I'm now getting into a really good amount of trade bucks just by continuing to smell this coupon. That's a good one. Anything else?
You create a user with the name quotes or 1=1 hash, and then do the view users with a similar name to you. It's a SQL injection.
Yeah, so who's got a similar name to you? So this one's actually really tricky. So I'll show a quick example of this because I don't want to do the whole exploit. But if you register as a user, we'll call our username. I don't know if this will work actually. Oh, it's a similar name, so it's first name, right?
I remember if it's username or first name.
Test. Who got a similar name as you? We can see that it's giving me all of them, which means that it's a second order SQL injection, right? So I created a user, and now when I go to the view similar users page, I can see all the users. So then I can do this and inject data or do kind of whatever I want. Get more information. Like extract their passwords too, like really cool stuff. Cool. Alright, it's been a good semester. Final on Wednesday, probably not the note I want to end on, but go out, do ethical hacking stuff. Don't do anything unethical. Or if you do and then get caught, don't say you learned it in my class.